Hi guys, I wanted to make a little video update for you instead of doing another podcast episode. And I kind of wanted to share what's been going on with me and my family for the last 2 months through most of the summer. I originally was going to do a podcast episode, and I was kind of hoping that we would eventually clear some of the health struggles that we have been having. And finally, kind of reach a place where we could move forward from that. And it really just hasn't happened. So I kind of decided that I've been wanting to kind of update on the Breathing It Out Facebook page for a little while now. And I figured this might be a good way to do it. So we'll kind of see how it goes. I think you'll very quickly realize why I do a podcast and why I don't normally do videos, because on the podcast, I have lots of preparation. I do like copious notes. I even write a script sometimes. There's a lot of editing so that it's as kind of chronological order, as in chronological order as possible, I guess, and so that it's as digestible for the listener as possible. I think with this, it's going to be my head's kind of all over the place, and I think you'll see that. And I think I'll probably kind of jump around, so you'll kind of have to bear with me with some of that. I think it's challenging to do a video or just even an update in general right now because with the podcast, I was telling things from the past mostly that were hard and challenging that I've kind of gotten through. And I was talking about it from a place of kind of peace and power that I overcame those things. And right now we're kind of going through it a little bit. And so it's a little harder to share those things when I'm in it. It feels a lot more vulnerable, I guess, to kind of share what's really going on right now. And excuse my voice, it's still kind of not, I lost it from being sick, so it is back, but it's kind of still, you can hear it a little bit. But basically, I'll kind of try to do a long story short, although I'm long-winded, so it'll probably be a long story. And I've done some updates, posts that I've done on the Facebook page here and there, so some of you may be aware of some of what's going on, but there's kind of some other updates. We had a pretty good summer early on. My family and I went up to visit my dad and stepmom up in North Dakota for a little while. We had a great time. The next weekend, we went to my mom and stepdad's house, and we had a lot of fun with them. And a day after we got back from my mom's house, Jackson got sick. And he had a fever, he had a really bad cough, really congested. And initially, we were like, well, maybe it's COVID. So we tested him and it was negative. And so we just kind of monitored him for a little while, tested him again. I think it was negative. And he had like 4 or 5 days of a pretty darn good fever and just felt yucky and his cough sounded really bad. On like the fourth or fifth day of him being sick, I started feeling sick and I had a fever, cough, kind of all the same things he did. But on day two of that for me, my temp was like 103 plus, and I was coughing, my lungs felt awful. And I was like, this is not good. So I contacted my CF team. I let them know that, I was sick, and they said they wanted to run a respiratory panel on me, which is basically just like a nasal swab, kind of like the COVID test, that tests for the most common like respiratory viruses. So it's like COVID, RSV, flu, other types of colds, rhinovirus, and that type of thing. And we got the results back for that, and it was RSV. So that's how we knew Jackson likely had it. I had it, and Ellie also got sick at the same time as I did. So she had a fever and a cough and all that too. And Chad did, we think Chad kind of got RSV. Like he had a few very mild symptoms, but largely he felt okay, which was, I was like, lucky guy. So I called when they found out it was RSV, they decided because I was feeling so crappy that I should probably be put on an antibiotic. And that's not because an antibiotic treats RSV, but it's because with CF, I grow that bacteria in my lungs all the time. And when you have a virus in there, it can kind of make the bacteria even worse. So they put me on that antibiotic, and within a day or two, and it's just an oral, like pills antibiotic. Within a day or two, I started feeling a lot better. And I mean, that's relative. my temp came down from like 103 to like 100, 101. My coughing started to kind of get better, but I still feel very worn out and sick through that whole time. On day 6 or so of me being sick, Chad had been planning this bike ride that he does pretty much every year. He's a big, you know, bicyclist. He races at times and does rides and all that. And he was planning to go do Ragbri in Iowa, which is a big bike ride across Iowa. He was only going to do a couple days of it. And it's his favorite thing every year. He always plans for it for a long time. And since I was feeling better, I still had a low fever. And the kids were kind of moving in the right direction. I was like, yeah, go ahead and go. And so he did that for 2 days. We all kind of started, the kids felt a lot better by the time he got back. I was finally like without a fever for like a day of, and I had like 8 days of fever. So I had been pretty sick. He comes home on a Monday. By Tuesday night, he is coughing, congested, fever of over 101 and feels like crap. And we were like, okay, he must have RSV now. Like maybe he didn't have it before, or maybe he did, but it just kind of got worse because of doing the bike rides. So that must be what he has. And we just assumed that was the case. And then, so that was a Tuesday night, he felt bad. By Wednesday, his friend that he had done a bike ride with the last couple days texted and said that the other person that they did the bike ride with just tested positive for COVID. And I just freaked out inside, I guess, because it was like, yeah, that's exactly what he has. I'm sure he has COVID, not RSV. I was like, we need to test you now because we've now been exposed the last day or so of you coughing all over the place down here near us, thinking it was RSV that we already had. So we get a COVID test. He takes it. It's positive. And so that's when I did an update, I think, on the Facebook page saying, you know, I was crying. I was really overwhelmed because I had just kind of got back on my feet. I'd only been without a fever for a day or two after like 10 days of illness. I've been taking care of the kids while they were sick also, and just felt so overwhelmed. And I was like, if we catch COVID from Chad, I'm probably going to be in the hospital, and I just don't know if I can do this anymore. Like I was very tired, and you know, when you're that sick and kind of exhausted, there's no coping skills left. It's just instant tears for me, at least. So that's what happened. And then I posted, a lot of you had some really nice feedback saying, hey, we had COVID, but we, you know, so-and-so in our house had COVID, but we never caught it, and stories like that, which like gave me hope, calmed me down. It's like, okay, let's not like count our chickens, right? So he immediately quarantined in the bedroom. The rest, you know, the kids and I always kind of stayed downstairs as much as we could. And he got decently sick. He had fevers for a few days. He was coughing a lot. He lost his taste and smell and all that. Like he got hit pretty hard. But on day like 5 or 6, the kids and I hadn't had any new symptoms, and we tested for COVID and we were all negative, and we're like, okay, I think maybe we can avoid catching it. So, and obviously we knew there was still a chance, but we're like, I think we're probably okay. So, I knew I'd lose my train of thought doing videos like this. So, he started feeling better. He quarantined for like 7 or 8 days, I'd say. And then on day like 9 or 10, he tested and he was negative. And so after like the 10th day, he was out of quarantine, and we're like, okay, we all still feel good. Awesome. Then about like 5 or 6 days after he was out of quarantine and like deemed, you know, not contagious, I started having a sore throat and congestion. And I was like, it was very mild. I almost didn't kind of realize that's what it was. And I was like, well, maybe it's allergies, because I do tend to have allergies around this time of year. But I was like, just to be on the safe side, I'll take a COVID test. So I tested, and after 15 minutes, it looked negative. And I was like, awesome. And then I kind of waited, because you can check between like 15 and 30 minutes. And around like 20 to 30 minutes, I start to see like this shadow of a lion on there. And I was like, I don't know if that's, I wasn't convinced, but I was like, I don't remember seeing that on our other negative COVID test, which is kind of concerning. So we treated it as though I had COVID for that day. And I was like, I'm going to test again tomorrow and then probably get a more convincing line or not. And then we'll kind of know, you know, what we're dealing with. So I checked the next day and it's almost fully negative, if not less of a shadow than it was the day before. And I'm like, maybe this is just on all of the tests. Maybe it's like an evaporation line that you can get on like a pregnancy test type thing. So we're like, okay, I guess I don't probably have COVID then. And my symptoms didn't get any worse. I still just had congestion and sore throat, but that was kind of it. I felt fine. I was like downstairs jogging at times and doing all the things I needed to do. I didn't feel bad. So I was like, it can't be COVID if it hit Chad that hard. And we're both vaccinated. So I figured if it hit him that hard when he's vaccinated, it would hit me that hard too, plus. So that was like a Wednesday and Thursday that I tested. And this happened to be Ellie's meet the teacher night and then first day of school. So I missed both of those, which was a really big bummer. Then Saturday, I was like, you know, I still kind of feel those symptoms. I never got any worse, but I'm gonna take a COVID test to check again and just to make sure. And I took it and this time it was totally positive. I was like, shit. So I was glad on the one hand that I had COVID and felt really good, but I had been around Jackson the last 3 or 4 days with symptoms without a mask, other than the first day I had a mask on when we thought I had COVID, but the other 2 or 3 days I wasn't. And I was like, perfect. So, and that was on day like 4 of symptoms for me. By day 5 or 6, Jackson started to not feel well, which was kind of like obvious, of course. So he started to be congested. He actually had a decent fever and kind of had it a little bit harder than I did. And I think that's probably because he wasn't vaccinated yet. So he felt pretty sick for a couple days. Largely, he did fine. And Ellie actually had gotten her booster vaccine like right after Chad tested, like right after Ellie tested negative after being exposed to Chad, we got her booster in hopes that if one of the rest of us catch it, like she might be able to avoid it, which was maybe stupid or maybe not, but we were hoping that would work. And seemingly it did because she never did catch it. But so when Jackson started getting sick, that was like day 5 or 6 of symptoms for me. And on day 6, I actually started coughing up some blood, a little teeny bit. And to anybody who's listened to the podcast on episode, I think it's 11, I talked about my kind of big history with coughing up blood at times and that being such a big struggle for a few years. And so it was something I had seen obviously in the past, but I hadn't had any bleeding from my lungs since I started Trikafta, that medicine that changed everything. So it was a big bummer and it was confusing because I was like, I don't feel sick. I've been up and jogging and my lungs feel pretty good and I just don't feel sick. It's so weird that I didn't cough up blood when I had RSV and I was super sick and my lungs were super gunky. But now that I have COVID and I feel fine, I mean, largely, now I'm coughing up blood. So it's like, cool. So that's when I called my CF team or messaged them and said, hey, I tested positive for COVID. I'm letting you guys know now because I was previously feeling fine, just very mild symptoms, and now I'm having some bleeding from my lungs. Kind of what's the plan? And so then they put me back on an oral antibiotic, which I had been on it for RSV for like 2 weeks and then off for like a week. And now I'm back on it again. And I think knowing that I had oral antibiotics as an option, just pills, was really helpful mentally for me because I'm like, okay, we haven't tried all the things yet. So like, let's try oral antibiotics and hopefully that will stop the bleeding. And so the other thing that you do when you have bleeding is I have to stop a couple of different nebulized medications that can irritate my lungs, and one of them actually can kind of break up clots, I guess. So that's something you don't want to take when you're bleeding, because you need to clot so you can like heal. So I have to stop those. I have to stop my percussor. I have to stop my vest, both of which shake my lungs and can cause more bleeding. I have to stop exercise. And then they started me on that antibiotic. And it within a few days, well, within a day, the bleeding stopped. Within a few days, I could kind of start adding some of my treatments back on. And as long as I wasn't bleeding anymore, I could continue adding those on. And so within a few days, I was back to my full treatments. I had no more bleeding. And I was like, okay, that's really good, because the bleeding cycle that I'll talk about in a minute is awful. So, okay. That was day six or so, excuse me, of COVID. And by day, like I started feeling better, no more bleeding. Jackson started feeling better. I was kind of out of my quarantine period and testing negative. Jackson was at the very end of his quarantine, like 10 days. We didn't actually even test him, but he was on day 10. And I was finally feeling like, okay, we're finally getting to this positive, like we're clearing all the health problems. We're gonna be okay. And on day 10, I get a call from Ellie's school, and she is sick in the nurse's office with a fever of like almost 101 and congested. And I'm like, shit. So I go pick her up from school. She feels awful. We COVID test her and she's negative. I'm like, okay. I mean, I'm assuming it's probably COVID, but maybe not. And by that night, her temp is 103.8. And I'm like, that, yes, it could be COVID, but it doesn't strike me as COVID. That's a high temp immediately. And she's vaccinated. I just didn't see that as being COVID, but I was like, we'll check her again, the next day or something. And through the night, she had a kind of a rough night, had a fever, obviously, all night, and then woke up and her throat hurt so badly. Like she was crying, it hurt so bad. I'm like, this sounds like strep. And she has had strep before. And so I looked in her throat, it was red throat, swollen tonsils, white patches on there. And I'm like, we're gonna go to urgent care. Because it was a Saturday. I'm like, I'm not gonna wait till Monday if it's strep, when she could get on an antibiotic right now and feel better by tomorrow. So we go to urgent care. They test her for strep and they test her for COVID. Her strep test came back negative, which I was like, bummer, kind of, because it's an easier fix if it's strep potentially. So the doctor or the PA or whoever was there came in and said, said she's got all five of like the main criteria for strep, which I couldn't list them, but she had them all. And she said that when she like looked in her throat, it smelled like strep because it's got a distinct smell. And she's like, I'm gonna treat her anyway for strep. So she called in an antibiotic, thank goodness. And she, Ellie took it that night. And then by the next morning, well, I told Ellie the night before, I was like, if it's strep, you'll take this. And I bet you anything, by the morning, you'll feel so much better. And she woke up that morning, she came down the stairs and she's like, I feel great. I was like, it's strep. Pretty sure it's strep. So that was good because it was something we could treat. And I was already on an antibiotic, so very likely, and it actually treats strep. So I very likely wouldn't catch that, which was like good. And Jackson and Chad avoided strep, so yay. And then, so once again, it felt like, okay, we've had RSV, we've had COVID, we've had strep. Are we done now? I think we're done now. And on Sunday, so this was Saturday, she went to urgent care. On Sunday, I was like in a good mood. I was baking muffins. I was getting ready to go jog right after the muffins were done. And I started coughing up blood again. And this one hit me differently, like emotionally, because I knew that the first time it happened, the 2 weeks prior, I wasn't on any antibiotics. And I was like, we can do oral antibiotics and it will probably, hopefully, fix it. This time, I was on the end of antibiotics, oral antibiotics. I was like on the last day, and now I'm coughing up blood. And when I say, I mean, it's very small quantities. Obviously, anybody who's coughing up lots of blood needs to go to the ER. That was not my case. It was like little quantities. But clearly, there's an infection in there that's damaging my lungs to some extent, and it's causing some bleeding. And so I just, it just like drained my energy and my, instantly it was like devastating. Because generally in the past, if an oral antibiotic doesn't cut it, doesn't make you feel better, doesn't fix the problem, you go to IV antibiotics, which is normally in the hospital. Now, sometimes I can do them at home, but largely it's in the hospital, and then maybe they'll send me home on IV antibiotics. So it's been almost 4 years since I've been hospitalized, and it just felt like we got hit with a ton of bricks, knowing that likely the response from my CF team is going to be, you need IV antibiotics. And it was so infuriating because my lungs do not feel bad. Like they felt a little tight in that area that had bled previously, like the 2 weeks before, but I didn't feel bad. I was getting ready to go do a 5K jog. Like I was up doing all the things, not feeling ill. So it was really frustrating, beyond frustrating, when that happened. And I remember walking downstairs and telling Chad, and he could tell I was sad. I wasn't really crying yet, but he could tell I was really upset. And he came over and gave me a hug, and he was like, it's okay. It'll be okay. And I just started crying, and I said something about, I don't want to go in the hospital, or I don't want to have to deal with this and what this means. And it was kind of like he kind of finally connected the dots, because like I don't think he realized that like I was at the end of an oral antibiotic treatment. Kind of normally what's next is IV antibiotics, which is hospitalization. And so you could just kind of see it on his face, like, oh, I didn't quite realize that was next. And it was just so overwhelming, sad. We talked. I mean, I think at first we kind of needed to process on our own. And I think you kind of, for me, I start going worst case scenario. What's the worst case scenario? And it almost felt kind of PTSD adjacent. I don't want to overuse that term for people that really have gone through something traumatic and are diagnosed with that. But I think me and my family have been through some pretty traumatic things with my health. And it just kind of took me right back to where I was 4 years ago before Trikafta, when bleeding started happening after influenza. And we did IV antibiotics multiple times. We tried adjusting treatments and all sorts of stuff, and inevitably I was, for basically 3 years of my life, I was coughing up blood, little bits, daily or a couple times a week, or even like every week or two eventually when we got adjusted a few things. But it was something I could never kick, and it was this awful cycle for so many years. And the reason it kind of becomes a cycle is, when you have an infection that damages the lungs to the point where you're bleeding, like I said, they want you to stop those treatments and the vest and the percussor and the exercise so that you don't have more bleeding. But then that infection sits in there and you're not really clearing it. You're just letting it sit there. And then it causes more infection, which causes more bleeding. And you get to this point where it's like, well, should I do my best today? Because I feel kind of tight. But is it going to clear out infection, or is it just going to make me bleed, which causes more infection? And it's awful. And I don't want to have to live that life anymore. And Trikafta kind of tricked me into, I don't want to say tricked, but changed my thinking completely with my disease. That there were so many facets of my illness that I didn't have to kind of deal with for 3 years, more than that. And I had kind of gotten in this place where it was like, well, maybe I won't ever have to deal. Like, it's nice to kind of dream a little bit. Like, yes, I have to do my treatments and stuff every day, and take good care of myself. But largely, a lot of my the things I had to deal with before Trikafta were mostly gone. And it was amazing. And so it was just overwhelming to think that that's what I was going to have to take on again. And so I cried off and on for a couple of hours, just like processing and catastrophizing and thinking of all the worst case scenarios and what this means for my family and what this means for the rest of my life. And then you kind of get to like, but what do we need to do right now? And what are the, who do we need to call? Who's watching the kids? I need to call my CF team. And it's just all really overwhelming. And Chad and I sat down kind of after we both processed kind of separately. And we talked through kind of all the things we were thinking about, concerned with, scared of. And, you know, initially I was talking and I was kind of saying, but what if this and what if that and what if this? And he was like, look, you know, we haven't got there yet. And I'm like, but I'm entitled to my feelings, which is true. And he said, you're right. But you also aren't going to go down like a positive road if you only focus on the worst, worst case, which we're not there yet. And I'm like, yes, you're totally right. And then he kind of shared some of his kind of worst case scenario thoughts and all the things that are impacted. And he kind of started doing the same thing that I was doing, like, but this is going to be terrible and this is going to be terrible and this is going to be terrible. And I'm like, but we're not there yet. So we both kind of were pretty decently good at talking each other down eventually. And that's what we did. And, you know, we kind of shared with Ellie what was going on. And that was such a bummer because she's old enough now to understand more about what's going on and how scary it kind of is. And it was hard for her, understandably. And so I kind of had to talk her down. And I'm like, this is going to be okay. This has happened before. We've been through worse. You were too young to remember, but we have. And it's going to be okay. So that's where we were on, that was this Sunday. And we ended up calling my mom, and she, because Chad has no PTO left for work because he had COVID and took off all these days, and we had taken a couple like little trips before that, so we had zero PTO left. So thank God my mom was able to come over, and even if I didn't end up going in the hospital, I was going to need to get some tests done probably. It just helped so much. She ended up coming over on Sunday, that same day I called her. And it helped so much, not only to just have her to talk to and bounce stuff off of, but just having her there knowing that if I do have to go in the hospital, she'll be there for the kids. And I trust, I mean, she's the one I would call to watch the kids if I can't be there, because she's my mom. So I'm so grateful that she came over. And I let my CF team know, and they contacted me the next day, Monday morning, and kind of talked to me about like how this all has played out. And I was like, you know, I don't feel bad. Like, that's the kind of frustrating, like, it would almost make sense if I felt like crap, because I'd be like, yeah, I need to go to the hospital. I feel like crap and I'm bleeding. So makes sense. With this, it was like, I do not feel bad. I don't feel bad. So I don't want to go in the hospital. I know I have some bleeding going on, and that is so freaking frustrating, but I don't feel bad. And so they're like, let's plan on extending your oral antibiotic for another week. Cause I've been on it for 2 weeks now. They're like, let's plan on doing it for another week, stopping your treatments and kind of adding them back in over the days like we normally do, and get some blood work done and get a chest x-ray. And we'll kind of reevaluate the plan after we see that. And so this was Monday. I went and did the blood work while my mom watched Jackson and Ellie was at school. And I got a chest x-ray. And the kind of, I don't know about surprisingly, because my lungs felt good, but often if they're bleeding, they look like crap on the x-ray. But it came back that it was pretty much unchanged from what I saw in the notes. I didn't see the x-ray itself, but It sounded like it looked pretty good as compared to my last one 3 months ago when I was not ill. So I hear from my doctor's office and they're like, yes, let's stick with the plan. You know, back off your treatments for those days and kind of add them on over time if you're not bleeding. And then we'll do another week of oral antibiotics. So that's where we are right now. I'm on, that was what, 2 days ago. So yeah, we're just kind of in this wait and see place. I haven't had any bleeding since Monday morning. I've added on a couple things and so far so good. Like I feel good. Yeah, that's kind of where we're at. And funny enough, not last night, but so Monday night, I hear in the middle of the night, Jackson starts coughing a bunch, like for 2 hours. And I'm like, so yeah, he woke up super runny nose, coughing, and he's done it the last couple days. And I think he feels fine. He doesn't have a fever. Like, I mean, I think he feels run down, but I don't think he feels crazy, crazy sick. But it just never ends. It's like, when are we gonna be better? Yeah. So that's kind of where we are. And it's kind of funny or weird, but like when I was really upset on Sunday, like one of the things that hit me is like I did this podcast, I mean, for lots of reasons, but in part to like give people hope that like it gets better. Good things can happen with CF and with the medical world, with science. And when I started coughing up blood that second time, it almost felt like I was like letting people down or something. Like I'm supposed to be telling the story of hope, and now I have crappy news to share. And it felt weird in a way, but I think it's probably a lot more realistic to how a chronic illness really is, because it's really nice to tell the happy story where you had the horrible things happen and now it's all good. That's not really chronic illness, generally. There's gonna be a lot of this. And that's why I think you just have to like be so grateful and so in the moment when things are really good, because it's gonna be a lot of this. Yeah, I think it's more real because this is my life. This is what happens. Really good things can happen. And then you have some really shitty things too. And yeah, so that's where we're at. There was just a few more things that I wanted to make sure to share. And one of them is that I'm definitely, even though I can easily go back to that place where I was sick all the time and having issues with bleeding lungs and things like that, I am in such a different place physically from then. My lung function is so much higher than it was. It was down in the 50s percentile-wise, and now it's low to mid 70s. And I feel good. And so even though it's easy to go to that really scary kind of negative place, there's so many positives that have come from Trikafta, obviously. And my health is hugely improved. Even if we are going down a scary road, which I don't know for sure that that's even happening, but even if that happens, I am in a different place now than I was then. And I have to kind of remind myself about that. The other thing I thought that I would share that is kind of random is I heard on a podcast recently, I think it was Armchair Expert with Dax Shepard, I think. Somebody was talking about how they're really struggling at times with worrying and stressing and ruminating and kind of thoughts that aren't productive, that aren't really getting you anywhere. And I definitely can struggle with that at times. And they had talked to, I think they either were a therapist or they talked to a therapist. And that person said, you know, one kind of tactic you can use is to kind of give yourself a set, like, finite time during the day. Like, say, you know, it could be 5 minutes, or it could be a half hour, or it could be an hour, whatever works for you. But let yourself know that, you know, from 6 to 6:30, I'm allowed to think about that topic. I can worry as much as I want. I can ruminate as much as I want from 6 to 6:30. But throughout your day, if you start to have those thoughts, to kind of tell yourself, hey, this time is not for that. I have that time between 6 and 6:30 set aside to kind of stress and worry about that. And I haven't put that into practice exactly, but I kind of thought that was, I don't know, something interesting to try. So if you struggle with that too, maybe that is something you, you know, might work for you too. I don't know. The only other things I wanted to make sure to share is that I am still going to put out the Q&A episode. I really have been working on it off and on throughout the craziness of the last couple months. And we do have some really kind of sweet clips that my mom recorded and my dad recorded separately, both talking about just kind of what their thoughts are on Trikafta and how my health changed so much, me getting pregnant finally, having a grandson, just some of their thoughts on all of that. Is you'll like it. I'm kind of interested to hear from people if kind of what they would prefer if I do updates on the podcast where it's audio only, or if you like the videos, and what is easiest for you to watch or you know, listen to. Because I'm kind of considering possibly doing some videos here and there as kind of an easy way to update just little bits along the way, I guess. I want to thank everybody for, I've gotten such like sweet and thoughtful feedback from the podcast. I thought, like I said kind of earlier, I thought I was kind of initially doing it because I was going to kind of share a hopeful story and maybe make people feel a little less alone along the way. And really, it has been maybe one of the most beneficial things I've ever done in my whole life. Even just the fact that when this thing happened with the bleeding, previously my response would be kind of emotionally take care of everybody else. They're going to be freaked out that I'm not doing well, so make it okay for them and hide it kind of from everybody outside of your inner circle. Don't share anything with anybody, which just kind of led to me feeling more alone and not seen, I guess. And so I think already, even just since doing the podcast, I've started to kind of shift my thinking when it comes to this stuff. It was kind of interesting because I really didn't do that. I really was pretty honest with, you know, Chad and my mom, and I wasn't really trying to kind of comfort them so much. I mean, I did a bit with Chad to kind of help talk us both down, but I also got really real about it too, which I thought was kind of an improvement. It's been great, and I think periodically I will kind of keep updating here and there. So thanks, everybody.